Good evening and happy Sabbath to each and every one of you who are watching us online on this Sabbath evening program. I hope you all had a good week and we are really blessed as we come together to praise and glorify His name. Wherever two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst. With this beautiful thought, I would like to welcome each and every one of you once again. And to begin for our opening song, let's all sing hymn number 272, Give Me the Bible. For our scripture reading, the speaker has chosen a text from the book of John, chapter 17, verses 22 and 23. Book of John, chapter 17, verses 22 and 23. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be perfect in one, that the world may know that you have sent me and you have loved them as you have loved me.
Let's pray. Our most gracious Father in heaven, God, thank you, Lord, for giving us this time where we all could come together, worship and praise your name. Would like you to bless the speaker of this hour, be with him, guide him, and give him the words that he might speak the right words and we might listen and understand it and apply it in our day-to-day life. Would like you to ask to you to bless the Corona warriors, be with each one of them, guide them and protect them as they try to save this world and this nation. Be with each one of us as we are listening to this online YouTube meeting. Be with each one of us and guide us, protect us from all harm and danger, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our special song will be given to us by Safina.
Sparrows has a place to lay its head, so why would I let worry steal my breath? Even the roses you have clothed in brilliant red, still I'm the one you love more than this. and it's time for them to turn. So I will trust you even when it hurts. You give me everything. You give me everything. You give me everything I need. You give me everything. You give me everything. You give me everything I need. When I can't see you lead me, when I can't hear you show me, when I can't stand you carry me, when I'm lost you will find me, when I'm weak you are mighty. You are everything I need. You give me everything. You give me.
Greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Once again, it is our privilege, after the end of the week's toil, come to the feet of God. The world is facing, as we all know, the pandemic. Months finished. The days, the weeks, and the months, but still this pandemic is going on. Many people call me, "Pastor, my father died. Where he will go? To hell or to heaven?" Some people say, "Pastor, my family members died. Where they will go? We don't have a chance to see them. We don't have the last glance also. What is this? What is going on in the world? What does the Bible say? If you want to go to heaven, if you want to reach heaven, the Bible says they should be buried in a proper way, but it's not going on. What to do? What is going to happen for our relatives, for our friends, for our family members? What's going to happen? What we need to do?" That's what the questions comes to me. So many people questions in this way. In the first one itself, we see that I gave them this answer. See what is there in your life. Whom you are keeping in your life. That is the main important thing. Today I am bringing to you the message from the throne of God. Here it says, who is there in your boat? Who is there in your boat? Many times we have seen the disciples along with Jesus Christ, they sail. Jesus is inside. Jesus was with the disciples. But here I am showing you a picture where Jesus Christ was standing outside the boat and is holding the boat. Nobody is there in the boat. It's a peculiar picture. I want to Think over it. And I put in the question here, who is there in your boat? The poets, they compare our life to the life of a boat. If you want to reach the other shore of the sea, that is the lifespan of man, what should be there? What precautions that we should take when we leave this earth? What precautions we need to take before leaving this earth to ascend to heaven? And here in the next slide, I'm bringing to you here in the book of Luke chapter 8 verse 25. Here we see the picture. Is there anyone who did not see this picture? You all might have seen this one, but I want to bring a different view from this picture. And here we see that the storm on the Sea of Galilee. The disciples and Jesus had witnessed the whole day. The disciples have seen how Jesus Christ raised the dead, how Jesus Christ healed the sick. And now Christ said, let us go to the other shore of the sea. And here we see that, here it goes on. Luke chapter 8 verse 25. And he said unto them, who said? Jesus. And he said unto them, where is your faith? It's a question. It's a question. Jesus Christ is asking to his disciples, where is your faith? And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, what manner of man is this? What manner of man is this? For he commandeth even the winds and water, and they obey him. Why they put this? Why they're having this thought in their mind? They have seen Jesus, how Jesus did all the miracles. And now they're wondering, what kind of man, what manner of man is this? And Jesus is telling, what happened to your faith? Why? Jesus asked this one. All this while they were there with Jesus, and now they are drowning in the Sea of Galilee. The storm came, and Jesus was sleeping there, and they said, Master, Master, wake up. Master, wake up. We are perishing. That's why Jesus questioned, where is your faith? You all this while, you are staying with me. You are mingling with me. You are seeing the miracles happening, but still you haven't got that faith. That means something is there in your life. It is not Christ. It is not that me in your life. Something is there in your life. That's why Jesus said, where is your faith? What happened to your faith? When we keep Jesus in our lifeboat, the faith comes to us. The strength comes to us. The sincerity comes to us. The holiness comes to us. And we can live with Christ. When we keep Christ in our life, then there is no question of getting this doubt, where is your faith? In the next slide, here I am bringing John chapter 8 verse 12. Again, Jesus spoke to them. Here, what picture we are seeing? I think you all have come across these situations reading from the Bible. A lady going to the feet of Christ and touching the feet of Christ. Who is this lady? Who is this woman? I think you can understand by seeing this picture, you can understand. Who is this woman? Yes, Magdalene, Maria. And here, when the people were throwing the stones at her, she ran for her life. And she ran and ran, and she fell on the feet of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ saw that. And all people gathered. Who are the people? The Pharisees, the big learned people, they all were there. They had learned through the scriptures. They had read the scriptures. They were learned people. And they were chasing this woman. Wanted to kill her. She was caught in a bad act with men, but the men were not chastened. but she was chosen and they wanted to kill her, and Jesus started writing on the ground. He bent and started writing. You all know this one. He started writing. What is writing? Who haven't seen first, throw your stone. One by one they have seen, and they all left there. And women, where are the people? Nobody left. I am also not punishing you. But see after that, see after the verse what Jesus said to them. John chapter 8 verse 12. Here it says again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Who is the light? Jesus is telling to them, because they have seen, they also have seen, they also have witnessed what miracles Jesus is performing. But who is there in their heart? Who is there in their mind? Not Jesus. They don't have Jesus in their mind. They have something in their minds. And that's why they wanted to chase this woman. They wanted to kill this woman. And here they don't know what is light, what is darkness, what is the scripture says. And Jesus answered and saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. What a marvelous word that Jesus says. We have seen many, many, many. We have seen many avatars. We heard about many avatars. There are many avatars. According to the heathen, we see there are 10 avatars. And Jesus Christ is the 11th avatar, they say that. But in all these 10 avatars, nobody says that, I am the light of the world. And if you keep the light, if you follow me, you will never walk in darkness. That's what he says. Who should be there in our boat? Who should be there in our boat? Who should be there in our hearts? Who should be there in our mind? Who is there? That's what the question. Who is there in your boat? Is Christ is there? Jesus Christ is telling that. What he is telling? I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. Do you want to walk in darkness? Don't think about these lights. Christ is talking about the spiritual light, the spiritual life. When we don't have the spiritual life in us, our life will be a miserable life. We cannot have peace. We cannot have happiness. We cannot have joy. We cannot enjoy this life which is given by God. Psalmist says that if you have strength, maybe 17 years, if you have more strength, or 8 years. After these 8 years, how we are spending our life? Are we spending with Christ? Are we having Christ in our life as we carry the word of God or the name of God as Christian we are carrying? But what is there in us? By seeing the miracle of God, by reading the word of God, by hearing all these things, whom we are keeping in our lifeboat? Is it Christ or the world? If you want to walk in the light, let us keep this light. I am the light of the world, says Jesus Christ. And whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. We need to follow Christ. Then only we can have Christ in our life. We can have Christ in our life. Let us go to the next. We see a person here. He enjoyed his life. Maximum he enjoyed by killing the Christians. Maximum he enjoyed by dragging the Christians to the prisons. He enjoyed. But finally he came to know, there is no happiness, there is no joy in this world. There is no joy in this worldly life. Something should be there. I'm lacking something. I'm not having something in my life. I should keep something in my life. That's what this man realized. Who is this person? Apostle Paul. Apostle Paul. What he says, we can see here the book of Philippians chapter 1 verse 21. For to me to live is Christ. What is telling? For to me to live is Christ. And to die is a gain. Hey, what a marvelous word he said. The one who kill the Christians, the one who dragged the Christians, now is telling, for me to live is Christ. Can we say that? Can we say that? Can you and me say that? For me to live is Christ, to die is a gain. Can we say that? When we want to walk in the light, when we want to have a joyful, a spiritual life, we all need to have Christ in our lifeboat. Then only we can have that. And here, I want to bring one more issue in the next slide. See in this slide, you can see a woman putting something red one down through the window. You can see that both are the same pictures, the same lady. She is putting something down. What is this? Joshua chapter 2 verse 11. Joshua chapter 2 verse 11. As soon as he heard it, we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. A heathen lady is telling, a heathen lady is witnessing, the ones who walked with Jesus Christ in the wilderness, who walked with God in the wilderness, the Israelites who walked with God, and God walked with them, who have shown many miracles to the Israelites. When they walked daytime, God has sent the pillar of cloud. When they traveled, when they journeyed the night time, God has sent the pillar of fire. And they have drank the water from the living rock. And they had eaten the manna, the angel's food. But still, they denied God. They grumbled at God. They grumbled at God. And now, here we see a heathen lady, what she is telling, as soon as we heard it, this lady is telling, as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. The heathen trembled when they have heard the miracles of God done towards the Israelites. They melted, it seems, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord, your God, she didn't say our God. What she, this lady is telling, Rahab, what she is telling, for the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. What a witness, he said. When Joshua went to spy the land of Canaan, Jericho, when he went to spy the land of Jericho, there they have seen, here the lady is telling, okay, now you have come to me. We have seen you. We have heard how the God of Israel had done miracle, how the Red Sea had parted. What a mighty God. Now, no longer I want to live with these heathens. No longer I want to keep the heathen gods in me. No longer I want to stay with these heathens. Now I heard, now we tremble, and now I acknowledge that your God is a God, the true God. He is a God in heaven and the earth beneath. That's what she witnessed. Can we do that? Can we do that? When we leave our homes, when we leave our cities, when we walk, when we travel, can we witness that? Because we are called as Christians. We are carrying the name of God. We are carrying the name of God anywhere through by saying that we are Christians. But are we carrying Christ in us? Is Christ there in our life? That's what we need to think. The heathen lady, the Rahab is telling that your God is a true God. He's telling, he is a God in heaven above and he is a God on the earth. Your Lord is your God. He is the true God. A heathen lady. My dear believers, not simply seeing and reading and going, not simply spending a few hours in the church of God, We need to have Christ in us. We need to carry Christ in us. We need to have Christ in our life word. As he said, I am the light of the world. We need to have that light in us. Then only we can have the peaceful, happy, joyful life on this earth as well as in heaven. Then only we can have, then only our names can be written in the book of life. If we don't have Christ in us, we have seen in the first slide how Christ is asking, what happened to your faith? Where is your faith? All this while you are walking with me, where is your faith? And now this lady got faith. Just by hearing that God of Israel had done miracle near the Red Sea, God of Israel had done miracles in the wilderness, God has provided them the manna, God has provided them the water. She just heard. And what she is telling, our hearts melted when we heard all these things, because your God, or the Lord, your God, he is a God in heaven, he is God in earth. We need to carry him in our boat. If our life is without Christ, there is nothing. There is nothing that we can go. And we can go to the next slide where you can see, you all have witnessed this one. Joshua chapter 24, verse 15. In this slide, I'm not reading all the verse, but one verse, we all know it by memory. We all know it. Joshua led the Israelites, and he was with the Israelites, he was with Moses, and all the people have witnessed, but now they revolted against God. They revolted against the living God. Now they don't want to stay, cling to God. Now they started worshipping the idols, and that's why Joshua had said these words. Joshua said this, choose this day whom you will serve, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What he said in Joshua? He forgot, he did not forget how the Lord has led the Israelites. He did not forget how the Lord has parted the Red Sea. He remembered everything, and he carried God in the living God in his heart. He carried the living God in his mind. He carried the living God in his way of life. That's why he could able to see when all the people everywhere, they're worshipping the heathen gods, they're worshipping the idols. Here, Joshua said, I don't want to follow that heathens. I want to follow only the living God, and the living God, the living God. He is God. That's why he is telling that today, you people, you choose anything, but for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. My dear believers, tonight, I am bringing this verse to you. Who is there in your boat? Again, the question, who is there in your life boat? Who is there in your life? Why God has sent us to this earth? For what purpose God has sent to this world? I want to bring one more through the next slide. Here in this picture, what do you see? Two pictures are there here. Ruth chapter 1 verse 16. Here we see two pictures where one side, one lady is holding the other lady, and one lady is walking again. Walking away. And here in the next side, we can see one woman, a young woman and an old woman covering up. And what we see here in this picture, what do you recollect it? If I don't put the scripture there, what you can recollect? There is a role model for every daughter and daughter-in-law. This is a role model from the Bible. We can draw it. A role model. When I say this role model, I remember one instance. Mrs. Kamala Das, she was the English poetess from Kerala. She used to live in Pune. Once she was on the bed. And one of the students came to me and asked, "Sir, one of our writer, she's a big lady. She was not getting up from her bed since so long. Would you able to pray for her?" Then I said, "It is not I. If she believes in God, God will heal her." And we prayed, and God heard the prayer. God, our living God, healed her. She got up from her bed, and she wrote a poem, very nice poem. I love it. I love that poem. She said, "Okay, here." She said, "I don't want to call you by name Sridhar. It is a heathen name he's carrying, but I want to call you as Satyaji, a role model for all the devotees." In that way, she said, a role model for all the devotees, and she wrote a poem and dedicated to me. I think that is the second last poem that she wrote, but this poem was not published, but it is with me. Here we see the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 16. "But Ruth said, 'Do not urge me to leave you or to turn from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God.'" Here, when our parents become old, many of the ladies, now I'm seeing in many houses, when the parents become old, they put them somewhere, they chase them somewhere, they don't want to keep them in the house. They want to put them away. And here we see Ruth and Naomi. All this while, Ruth was with them. And now Naomi is telling, "So now the famine, I don't have my husband, your husbands are also died. Now still you are young, go to your land and marry somebody." And say, but what Ruth is telling, the daughter-in-law is telling to the mother-in-law, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you, for where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge, and your people shall be my people, and your God, my God." How many of the women of the church can say this to your mothers, to your mother-in-laws? And we see that in the history, it is the women who builds up the house, who builds up the family. One woman left to her people, but the other woman is telling, "Don't urge me to leave you. Because you are old now, I cannot leave you and go. All this while you have taken care of me, and how can I leave you and go? And whatever you taught me, it is there in my heart." That's what she says. Your God is my God. Your people are my God. I'm carrying the name of God. That's what Ruth says. And the side we can see, the young lady, she's taking care of her mother. She may be her mother or mother-in-law. She's covering her. If every woman of the church, if every woman of this world take care of their family, there will not be any disputes in the families. There will not be any misery in their families. There will not be any fight among the family members. Every woman, a role model. Take Ruth as a role model in your life. But it's not only for the daughters or the daughter-in-laws. It is also for the sons and the son-in-laws also. We need to take care of this. Then only we can hear. And here in the next slide, I'll bring you, as the time is coming closer, I want to bring one more verse here. John chapter 17, verse 23. "I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me." I'm pressing here and reading. This is in the scripture reading. My daughter has read the scripture reading. Here, as I said in the beginning, there are 10 avataras, but no avatara has said this word. But here, the living God, we believe it. Jesus is the living God. The living God has said, "I in them." What he is telling? He is telling to the Heavenly Father. He is telling, "Oh, I in them and you in me." Jesus Christ is telling to the Heavenly Father, the living God, he is telling, "I in them," whom? The disciples, whoever makes the disciples, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. That's what Christ is asking. That's what Christ wanted to say. No human being, no gods or goddesses that we, the world is having. There may be three crores or more than three crores of gods or goddesses. No one had promised like this. The Christ is telling, though he is the Son of God, came to this world in the form of human, he never performed that way. He never acted in that way. He said, as you have loved my Father, as you have loved me, I am also loving them. Let them be one among us. That's what he says. I in them and they in me. And you in me. And you loved me. That's the love of Christ. That's the love of Christ. My dear believers, we need to carry this love. We need to carry the love of Christ. Let us, if we go towards the world and worldly things, we may not be having the heavenly kingdom. Our name may not be written in the book of life. If you want your name, my name, to be written in the book of life, we need to carry the name of Christ. The finally, I am reading here, Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1. Behold, behold, Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, or his ears dull that it cannot hear. We are having a God who stretched forth his hands, oh God who stretched forth his hands and calling you and me today. This is the time for you. This is for the time for us to realize. This is the last chance that God has given to us, my dear believers. This is the time for us to realize that we need to come to God. This is the time that we need to come to his feet, and it is the time for us to take God into our life, and we need to walk with him. When we walk with him, our names will be there written in the book of life. Then only that we can have the everlasting life. May God help us to have this eternal life. May God help us to have our names in the book of life. By following, by carrying the name of God is not only sufficient, but we need to carry his love, his light. Then we will be called the true Christians. May God help us to have this.
For our closing song, we'll sing hymn number 246, 246.
Let us pray. Let us ask the closing blessings from the Lord. Merciful Father, the Lord God Almighty, the Lord of Lords and God of Gods, the mighty God, thank you for this wonderful message that you have given us, Lord. We need to carry in our life the name of Christ, and we need to have the love of Christ in us, Lord. We need to have a life that is cling to the Christ. Help us to have that life, Lord. I pray for the school. I pray for the school upliftment, Lord, as Dr. Emmanuel is trying to bring up this institution day by day, the height by heights to it, the highest, Lord. And I pray for the college. Let this college bring glory and honor to thee, Lord. Let every step that is being taken be blessed. Help us to spread the message of the true love of Christ through this college also, Lord. And I pray for the conference, Lord. Bless the conference people. I pray for all the churches around the world. And I especially, I pray for all the bereaved families, Lord. Many families around the world, they're suffering without the parents, without the children. Oh Lord, I pray for them. Bless them. Fill their houses with peace and comfort, Lord. Give them the comfort, heart and mind, Lord. Bless these bereaved families. And I pray for all the doctors and the nurses, Lord. I pray for all the hospitals, Lord. I pray for every medical departments that are taking care of these people. Oh Lord, help us to be protected from this pandemic. When we carry thy name, we will be lifted up. Thank you for all the blessings and hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.